Hello, everybody. Welcome to Intermediate Accounting 17th Edition Video Solution Walkthrough for Exercise 2-8. This question comes from the Intermediate Accounting 17th Edition textbook. Authors are Don Kiso, Jerry Weingann, and Terry Warfield. The question used in the presentation is copyright 2019 by John Wiley and Sons. All rights are reserved for educational purposes only. The video may not be distributed or redistributed without the express permission of Wiley. This solution presentation is copyright 2019 to 2021 by Bennett Tchaikovsky. All rights are reserved. The opinions contained within this presentation are those of Bennett Tchaikovsky and not the authors of the textbook or of Wiley. Okay, so here's going to be, we're going to have some kind of some fun, which is we're going to be talking about the full disclosure principle. So if you were taking my class in intermediate accounting, one of the things I would have you memorize is this inverted pyramid or this tree. And the reason is that if you ever get a question that you do not understand, or if you get something that you don't know what to do, you can always come back to this, which is, you know, what's the overall objective of financial reporting? Providing information that the reporting entity that is useful to present and potential equity investors, lenders, and other creditors in their capacity as a capital provider. And then over here, we look at the qualitative characteristics. You'll see over here, relevance, faithful representation. They used to call this liability, but I guess the attorneys got them. And enhancing qualities. And this is more of the qualitative characteristics. So you can kind of see over here, it's this minus the enhancing, here's the enhancing qualities. And then you've got over here, relevance, reliability, or faithful representation. Yeah, there you go. So I have done some other overview videos on this. However, I don't know if I'm making these available to, I'll ask Wiley if I can actually make these available publicly, if I can do so. And if I can, I did a video, a couple different videos on this, but they're right now unlisted. So as we look here at exercise 2-8, under the full disclosure principle, so presented below are a number of facts related to Weller. Assume that no mention of these facts was made in the financial statements and the related notes. So what I want you to do is take the position that you're going to sign off on the financial statements for Weller, which is a very good bourbon, by the way. And if you can ever find the Weller 12, you know where to look for me. Over here, if I go to sec.gov and in the company filings, if I go to, let's just pick one, let's go Tesla. What you're going to notice over here, I'm going to look at the filing for Tesla, but just imagine you are the CFO for Tesla. I, Zachary Kirkhorn, you're basically signing your life away. The report does not contain any untrue statement of a material fact or admit to state a material fact. Based on my knowledge, it fairly presents in all material respects the financial condition of the operation. So you're an accountant. You're the CFO of this enterprise, and you're going to be signing your life away, essentially. So when we look at this, that's kind of the mindset that I want you to take when you're going through and doing this, is that if I allow something like this to happen, I need to be, and generally what I would tell you is, you know, they'll never say this anymore, but I would overstate your liabilities, understate your assets. It's not about being conservative. It's about doing what's right. And it's about fair disclosure. Right? And it's about full disclosure to the investors, right? So let's read through each one of these. The company decided that for the sake of conciseness, only net income should be reported on the income statement. Details as to revenues, cost of goods sold, and expenses were omitted. Wow. Okay. So here we go. We got a problem here, right? If we're eliminating revenues, how are we going to have any type of predictive value, right? If I'm looking at the financial statements, an investor wants to know, how did we do revenue-wise period over period? Just showing net income really doesn't reflect that. you can have an issue here with there's no predictive value if we do that. There's no confirmatory value. And confirmatory means that I've made a projection and it's confirming my expectations. I'm looking at information. I'm able to make future, future predictions. And materiality is probably also going to be an issue here too. Completeness, neutrality, you know, it goes on and on, right? So again, when you look at this, if you're not showing revenues and cost of goods sold and expenses, and you're just showing net income, really, what, how did you get to that number? Where did that number come from, right? There's just no way that you can't do that, right? You're going to go to federal prison, and none of us want to go to federal jail. Okay. State jail, well, if I'm going to keep us in there, I don't know how long it's going to last. Let's go to letter B. Equipment purchases of $170,000 were partially financed during the year through the issuance of $110,000 of notes payable. Company offset the equipment against the notes payable and reported plant assets at once at 60. All right, so let's see what's wrong with this. So when you actually, if you were doing this as a journal entry, you would debit equipment. I would credit notes payable, right? And then over here, I would credit cash for $60,000. So, you know, right over here as I'm looking at this, right? So what they're deciding to do is, we're just going to get rid of this note payable. So we're just going to make this equipment at 60. And we're going to say it's cash at 60. This is good stuff. All right. Now, the problem is that when I'm looking at the, so essentially what they're doing is they're not showing the liability. Well, what's wrong with that? Well, what happens if the there's a foreclosure, if they don't pay the note payable, like what's going to happen? Well, not good things will be happening. First off, you haven't really shown, you're not reflecting your obligations. This is material because you don't know what the terms are of that note. Is there some kind of like highlighted repossession? There's a lot of problems with not showing your actual liabilities from the transaction. You cannot net it. You're also understating your, so you're understating your liabilities by not showing this, and you're understating your assets because unless it's a BMW 7 Series, that probably drops at this value after a day. I'm just kidding. I'm not. But right over here, I've owned a my wife's owned a BMW, and it's an absolute nightmare. But right over here, as I'm looking at this, yeah. So you're understating your liabilities. You're understating your assets for letter B, and so that you just can't do it, right. So you're again. There's just so many different problems here. This is like total jail time. I can see you going to jail for this one if you added a few more zeros on it. And remember, it's never worth it because they're going to blame as accountants for everything. So it's better to be open and honest. And if you do have that temptation, you need to go to law school. Okay. So right over here, we've got predictive, confirmatory, materiality. It is material. Your financial statements are not complete because you're not disclosing with the liability. This is an error. Actually, this is more fraud. So that's not even, it doesn't meet the criteria for an error. Certainly, you know, you've got the, it's not, there's no, again, it's just, there's a lot of problems. Okay. Weller has reported its ending inventory at 2.1 million. Okay. And its financial statements, no other information related to inventories is presented in the financial statement and related notes. Okay. What I want to do with this is just kind of show you that as you're going through, and if we look at Tesla here, for instance, and let's just kind of see, we've got over here, they've got current assets. What else do we have here? Inventory. Okay. They've got 4.1 billion of inventory as of December 31st. So let's just do a little bit of an inventory search. Okay, let's just see what it has to say about inventory here. And okay, use of estimates. Okay. inventory valuation. Okay, so it says over here, inventories are stated at the lower of cost or net realizable value. So if you're showing an amount of 2.1 million on the financial statements, you also have to provide background in terms of how are you arriving at your doing your inventory costing? Are you doing it at the lower of, or are you using FIFO, LIFO, weighted average? How are you doing your inventory costing? So there's just a lot of, so right over here, so Tesla uses first in, first out. So the first goods in or the first ones out. So in order for us to really kind of go through, and let's see what other inventory disclosures there are. Okay. And also too, you see there's another inventory here for Tesla. Tesla is a manufacturer. Of their inventory, they had 4.1 billion of inventory. What did that consist of? Well, it was raw materials, WIP, finished goods. Going back over here, basically with Weller, I don't really know what they do, but if you just have 2.1 million and is that retail, you know, what method are you using? Like those are just kind of, those are different types of items. So again, that's a big problem. Okay, so not only do you have to show inventory, but you're going to also have to go through and show the disclosures relating to inventory. If you're a manufacturer, you're going to also, again, it's a lot of, they recorded write downs. So even Tesla writes down the value of their inventory. So again, you have to show a lot of different, there has to be a lot of different disclosures if you pledge any of your inventory for financing. So again, all of those concepts relating to inventory have to be disclosed in the financial statements. So not only are we going through and just, you know, reporting the numbers on the balance sheets and the financial sheets, we also have to disclose what's going on in the back. Okay. So the company changed its method of valuing inventories to weighted average to FIFO. No mention of this change was made in the financial statements. Wow. Okay. So here you go. Right. So when you choose an accounting method, you have to stay with that accounting method. Why? Comparability. I can't compare 1 year to the next if there be if different methods are being used to value the inventory. So right over here, I'm failing to have comparable financial statements, which is then going to impact the predictive value, can indirectly impacting the predictive value, the confirmatory value. Yeah, that's a pretty big problem. If you're changing your, you know, you're also going here too, is that one of the principles is the what we go through and how we do our measurement and how we go through and recognize expenses. So for inventory, that's really recognizing if we're changing our cost method, or if we're going through here and changing our method of valuation, that's impacting the amount of expense recognition because you're going to impact cost of goods sold. So there's a lot of problems with just changing it. Now, if you go through and do make a change in accounting principle, there's a lot of disclosure that you have to go through and make. You're going to have to show the prior period's financial statements under the new method. You're going to have to go through and more than likely make a prior period adjustment to retain earnings if the amount is materially significant. But if you're making a change in accounting principle, like switching from FIFO to LIFO, and why is it such a big deal? Because if we could switch every day or every year to see what's best for us, you know, that's basically you can manipulate profit. And so again, there's something, and it's not listed in here, but I would also say it would be really a matter of, I would want to say it's more along the lines of consistency, but we're kind of indirectly saying that by the comparability. So again, in my class, if you were taking the class with me, what I would have you do on your first exam is you're going to memorize this. And you got to memorize it, you know, or at least be enough familiar with it, like again, with each one of these parts, because if you don't know an answer to a question, this is what you're going to go back and refer to. I had a student who came into my office hour once, and she was working on a project, and I helped her go through it by really just, because it was a tough question and I didn't know the answer to it, but I went through and kind of looked at this. And a lot of times you're not going to know the answer, but if you look at these different items here, the recognition, measurement, and disclosure concepts, and then getting more and down over here into the qualitative characteristics, that's when you're going to have a better understanding of the material. So again, this is exercise 2-8. I want to thank Wiley for allowing me to use their awesome textbook. And obviously the images that I showed you are available via Z Library, but those are also the property of Wiley. Please don't forget to like and subscribe, and I look forward to seeing you on the next video. Have a great one.